My name is Judy Verkamme, and I work for a company called Interscience, which is a distributor of, amongst others, SIFT-MS. Today my presentation handled the use of SIFT-MS to classify different oils based on their origin. Yeah, the talk first mentions the relevance of the research, what is the importance of olive oil, because it's of course a very valuable product. And then I indicate a few different techniques that can be used to carry out this type of analysis. And then we go more into detail on the SIFT-MS approach, which is a unique approach. And based on the results, I hope that the customers or the attendees are able also to identify those unique features of the technology. SIFT-MS is a very interesting technique to carry out this type of research, because it is a very fast technique. That's the first advantage. But first of all, it's also a very selective technique, which means that the differences that presumably are available or are present within the olive oils, that were very easy to identify them or to detect them. I think it's very valuable for the SIFT-MS community. Yeah? We have been working here, or been working in with SIFT, let's say, for like 10 or 15 years. And what we see now, the last couple of years, that there is much more collaboration between the different distributors, etc. And I think that's a great advantage to get the technique more introduced across all kinds of different domains. Good afternoon, everybody. First of all, thank you to Anatune for giving us the opportunity to share the experiments that we did throughout the last couple of years. As already mentioned, I'm associated with Interscience. We are a distributor, just as Anatune from SIFT Technologies, but we do that in the Benelux countries. We've been doing that for already more than 14 years, and we have now approximately an install base of around 35 or 38 instruments. We are a multi-branded company, which means that we focus on different, or we apply different business units. I would like to briefly introduce three of them. First of all, we have GAS, which is our business unit that focuses on petrochemical industry and all the instrument and hardware developed in that context. Our second business unit is SampleQ, and in that business unit we develop automated solutions for sample preparation using auto-sampler technologies common to use in our business. And then last but not least, we have ESX, which is the ESX, or the Interscience Expert Center, which is in fact the business unit that I'm leading. And within that business unit, we carry out method development and validation application work. We carry out feasibility studies. We evaluate new techniques, new technologies. And it's also in that context that most of the time customers come into contact with us, because they have new innovative ideas and potential applications that would like to evaluate with the technologies. And one of those applications that we developed, I think, two summers ago, together with the University of Valencia in Spain, had to do with the evaluation of SIFT-MS, but then to discriminate or to classify different types of olive oils. Now, why are we focusing on olive oil or the olive oil industry? Because it is a very capital intensive industry. So it means that it has a lot of value. This is a scheme that I found on the internet, in which the olive oil market is estimated to be worth around 11 billion on a yearly basis. And as you know, whenever you have an industry in which there is a lot of money available, then you also have people who would like to pick a share of that money without doing the actual effort. So these are a few headlines from newspapers in which some frauds are mentioned, in which people are trying to sell olive oil from a different region while it is not the actual olive oil, or depleting olive oil with less valuable oil, etc., etc. So it is in fact in that context that we were asked to which extent SIFT-MS is capable of trying to differentiate between good and bad, or actual olive oil or not. So what are a few of those things that you have to take into account, or a few of the falsifications that might occur? First of all, low quality olive oil, which is falsely marked as being extra virgin olive oil. non-Italian oils that are being sold as being genuine Italian oils, olive oils that are being mixed with oils of lower grade, lower quality, or vegetable oils that are in fact being doped with adulterants, with chlorophyll to make it more green, or with carotene, so that in fact the color of the product more matches the active olive oil. So this is how currently olive oil is being specified, if I might say so. So we have the extra virgin olive oil, and of course that is the olive oil that we all would like to receive in our restaurant or when we purchase it. We have the virgin olive oil and the lampante olive oil, which is the olive oil of the lowest quality. So it comes from the second or even the third press of the olive oil fruits. And depending on their grades, of course, they have different prices, and the extra virgin olive oil is the most expensive one. So if you want to measure those type of products, obviously this is already being done, so it's not that we are inventing something new or in fact trying to develop something that has not been developed yet. These type of oils, they are already being classified, but in order to do so, you can in fact try to differentiate two different technologies. First of all, we have sensor techniques, which are being used for a very broad screening of the oil, or you can also use chromatography techniques for aroma profiling. And depending on the complexity or the amount of information that you actually would like to attain, you can use more and more complex chromatographic techniques with more resolution or multidimensional approaches. So first of all, the sensor techniques, what can you use? You can use techniques, spectroscopic techniques, such as infrared or Raman spectroscopy, so you get profiles, and based on differences in the profiles, which in fact arise from a difficult chemical constitution, so the different bonds that are available within the chemicals, you can classify the oils based on their identity, based on their chemical composition. What those techniques don't offer is what is in fact causing the differences. So what are the components, or on a component level, what are in fact the main differentiators or the main oil markers giving rise to that differentiation. But on a general screening approach, of course, this is very convenient and can also be achieved relatively straightforward and fast. If we then go to the opposite side of the spectrum, we can go to GCMS, and in this instance to comprehensive two-dimensional GC techniques, in which you can achieve high resolution, extremely high chromatographic resolution, so that you can in fact pinpoint on a single component level which components, which markers could be in fact responsible for a classification, a differentiation between the two different oils. And depending on how you would like to approach it, you can use additional techniques such as solid phase microextraction to achieve some kind of an enrichment prior to introducing the sample into the mass spec or into the GC. So that is the general approach. Now, what the question was that we would like to address is, to which extent is SIFT-MS capable of achieving that classification by doing a direct aroma analysis? So we are not injecting oil into the sift. You can do that once, but then you have to clean a lot. So what we are doing, because as you remember from also the previous discussions, SIFT-MS is a technique which is being used for volatile components, organic as well as inorganic components. So what we want to do is, we would like to create a headspace atmosphere under controlled conditions, because we're going to do a comparative approach, and we're going to introduce that headspace under controlled conditions into the instrument, and then try to identify or try to figure out, is there a way of achieving some kind of a differentiation. So this is how we did it. We have a 200 ultra instrument in our demo lab in Breda. Classic setup with helium as a carrier gas. The unique feature of what we are doing here, and this is something that I would like to emphasize particularly, is that all the work that has been done in the context of this classification, but also all the work that we are currently doing. Normally I do around 10 to 15 projects per year. We have done, I think, 80 to 85 throughout the last couple of years. But the last 2 or 3 years, we're only using the SIFT in full scan mode. Whilst initially, so when we're talking 10 to 15 years ago, SIFT was predominantly applied in a target mode. So you want to measure formaldehyde, then it's very easy. You just select formaldehyde from the library and you measure it. But what we are doing in this research, and what we are doing now also the last couple of years, is the opposite. Using the instrument in a full scan technique, just as we do on a GCMS in full scan mode, not to identify components, but to create, that was the assumption, to create profiles, unique profiles, compiled out of different peaks, and verify whether it is possible to use those aroma profiles, those headspace profiles, those full scan profiles, to achieve that classification. So we do scan mode, 5 repeats, positive reagent ions from 15 to 200 AMU with a dwell time of 10 milliseconds, so it's a very fast method because we don't have too much time, because we only have a limited amount of headspace volume available that we can introduce into the instrument. So within that time frame, we measure 5 full scan spectra for the 3 precursor ions that we are using, for the H3O+, the NO+, and the O2+. And we inject it in 4 milliliters per minute, so we have 1 minute of actual analysis time. So it means that, because I think we measured around 600 samples, 200 samples, but all in triplicate. So every first 10 minutes you have to wait, but then after every minute you get a result. So it's extremely fast to achieve high throughput analysis, and also to achieve, can I say, highly reproducible results, very precise results, because everything is being contained within an automated setup, and it's all very, very, very reproducible. These are the samples. I didn't count them, but I thought it was 130 or 128. I'm not sure anymore. But they were measured in triplicate, all of them, randomized, so we do not introduce any kind of bias, of which we are not sure prior to setting up the experiment. So the experimental design was randomized, and every 10th sample we did a pooled QC. So all of those oils, they were blended together to get a QC sample, and that QC sample was used to monitor the overall response of the instrument in function of time. So we have, you can see we have oils coming from different parts of Europe, even from Africa, Morocco, and then within every country also some different regions. And it was then the assumption, is it possible to classify not only within country, but also within a single country as well. So this is then how those spectra look like. We have customers calling it a chromatogram, and I always have to correct them and say, no, this is not a chromatogram, this is a spectrum. Or these are in fact 3 spectra. And this is one of the biggest advantages of SIFT-MS, is that you are able to achieve, generate or acquire 3 spectra, 3 full scan spectra, which are different. They are hugely different, but there can be certain nuances within those spectra, within a single run, within a single analysis from a single sample. And you can do that within a time frame of 1 to 2 minutes, which is in fact a huge advantage. So this is a high street olive oil. Then you see this is the sunflower oil, which is much less pronounced, much less complex, and it is based on those differences, obviously, that we are going to try to classify the samples. A brief summary of the measurement strategy. As I already mentioned, we are using a randomized sample sequence. Each sample was measured in triplicate, so that's for the statistics, obviously. Out of the 5 replicate analysis, we only use the 2nd, the 3rd and the 4th result. So the first measurement of the single measurement, so one measurement consists of 5 data points. So we only took the 2nd, the 3rd and the 4th data points. So the first and the last was eliminated from the results. And then all those results were compiled to get an average result per triplicate sample. And those results, those data, they were then subsequently transferred to a data, what do you call it, a data software, which is being used to do then the classification. So what we are doing here, this is important, I think, for people who are also considering of applying this strategy, is which data do I use? Because normally what the SIFT is producing are concentrations. You get 18 ppb of ammonia, or 5 ppm of hexane or of benzene. But now we're looking at raw data. So which raw data do I have to use? You cannot use the raw data which are generated, in fact not in the software version, Vaughn, correct me when I'm wrong, that we are currently using, to take ICF corrected data out of LabSIFT. So what we are doing is we are exporting the data, the raw ICF corrected data, from the CSV data files. So we open the CSV data files and we then import that data to a software tool that we developed ourselves. We called it the LabSIFT data exporter. And that information then we can then more conveniently use to get rid of data, to calculate averages, etc. And that information is then being introduced in this context or in this particular case into MATLAB. So this is how our little software tool looks like. So what we can do is we select the CSV files we want to process. We can indicate which data files we want to use and which data files we don't want to use. It is just as on a printer, print from page 2 to page 4. So this is what we do here. And for that information, the software is then going to calculate an average, and that information is then being exported, in this case, to an Excel data file. And then you get Excels that look a bit like that. If you can touch it, you can read it like if you're blind. So in the first column, we have 19, which stands for the H2O plus precursor. So we have 180 results. And then in the second column, we have the product ions. So starting from 15, 16, 17. And then every column is in fact a data file. Each column is in fact a sample. So this is a very convenient format. It's very easy, very straightforward. And it can also be very conveniently exported to all kinds of data processing software, like the Pirouette that Vaughn mentioned. People here were using MATLAB. You also have R or Python, all types of data processing software and algorithms that are being applied. But being able to provide it in such a format is very, very easy and very straightforward than to import. So this is then the statistical interpretation being carried out. So what was done? The data were split. This is a general approach being applied in this type of analysis. So you split your data. In this particular case, it was a 7-to-30 split. So you have a training set and a test set. So you develop a method and then you validate the method with your test set. First of all, there was a principal component analysis, unsupervised, just to explore the data to verify do we have particular outliers that we have to remove from the data set whilst then subsequently moving to the PLSDA modeling. We did three models. The first model is a multi-class model in which the different countries, the different regions were compared next to each other. To which extent is it possible to classify them? And then two-class models. One for Spanish olive oils and a second one for Moroccan olive oils. And then also a Venetian blind cross-validation was carried out with 10 data splits. And then to show some results, this is how those results then look like in a three-dimension as well as in a two-dimensional view. And then what I particularly would like to mention here is the differences between the different precursors. So they actually confirm the fact that the spectra or the ionizations that occur between the three precursors are in fact different. Because obviously the colors, they are associated with a certain olive oil. But you can see here the purples are located here on the H3O+, but they are located entirely different compared to the other ones on the other precursor ions. So, in fact, confirming the fact that there are differences in ionization occurring between all the different components in the mixture when being administered to the different precursor ions. This is the conclusion from the scientific publication, because these details have been published, and obviously they always have positive conclusions with excellent results and excellent classifications, etc. So I'm not going to read it out loud, but the general approach in which we assumed, is it possible to achieve classification using SIFT-MS in a high throughput fashion, was in fact confirmed. And this was the first project that we did. As I mentioned, it was done 2 years ago. And within those 2 years, I think we did 15 more projects, not only focusing on oil, but also focusing on other food products. So the classification approach is really a valuable new asset that can be relatively straightforward, be achieved by means of SIFT-MS, particularly when you combine it with the high throughput automatization with an auto sampler. I don't have a thank you word, but I only have an Italian saying, which say you have to live your life slowly so then you can become of older age. If somebody would like to have more information, please do contact me. My contact details are also available through Anatune. But I also have one additional slide that I would like to mention, is that we have been talking here now about full scan analysis classification, but something that we cannot forget is when we are doing this type of analysis work, is that by doing full scan analysis, you're not losing the absolute quantification capacity of the instrument. So what we are doing here, or what you can do also, is retrospective quantification. So we have a full scan spectrum available. You have a LabSIFT library that contains reaction data, reaction kinetics from a lot of components, more than 1,000. So it is relatively straightforward to use and combine that information. So when you have full scan data available, it is relatively straightforward also to verify what is the concentration of heptanol within those oils. Or after 2 or 3 years, for example, we have found a new contaminant. Was that contaminant already available or present 1 or 2 years ago in our data files? You still have those data available, so it is very straightforward once you get your hands on the quantitative classification information to retrospective quantify or verify whether those components were present, but also at which concentration they were available or present in your sample. That was my story on the olive oil. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Yuri.